So in the last class, we have discussed about the pulse code modulation as an important component of a digital communication system. And before taking up today's topic on DPCM and DM, let me very briefly tell you what are the advantages and what are the limitations associated with pulse code modulation system. So let me start with the advantages first. Let me write it down, the advantages of a PCM system. So there are several advantages associated with the pulse code modulation system. So let me summarize one after another. So first of all, you know that in case of a PCM system or pulse code modulation system, any information bearing signal is represented by means of zeros and ones. So unique kind of representation. So unique representation irrespective of the type of the actual signal. Unique representation by means of zeros and one. So let it be a voice signal or video signal or image signal, irrespective of the type of the signal, all the signals are represented in the forms of zeros and ones. And as a matter of fact, these signals, when they are represented by means of zeros and ones, they can be multiplexed together. And the multiplex signal can be allowed to traverse through a common channel. And ultimately, each of the signals can be demultiplexed at the receiver end and can be reproduced at their corresponding receiving end. So as a matter of fact, because of this use of the coded pulse for the transmission of information bearing signal, different types of message signals can be embedded together. So that can be regarded as one of the important advantages associated with this pulse code modulation system, which could not happen for an analog modulation. As for example, if I consider analog modulation like amplitude modulation or phase modulation or frequency modulation, then if you want to transmit different signals, for example, audio signal, voice signal, video signal or image signal, then you have to take different means for the transmission of those signals. But here, by virtue of those coded pulses, a single channel could have been used for the transmission of those zeros and ones. So this is the one of the important advantages associated with the pulse code modulation system. Now next, the second advantage which you can point out with respect to PCM system is the enhanced security. So although this point has not been yet discussed, but still, for the time being, I would like to mention, how can you improve the security of any digital communication system? Now, as you know, in case of digital communication, the signals are transmitted in the forms of zeros and ones, and there could have been some redundancy within the zeros and ones, or within this train of zeros and ones. And as a matter of fact, you can invoke different efficient algorithms so that those redundancy can be removed to some extent. And at the same time, while transmitting those information, there is a possibility that this information might be traced by some other party, by some third party. Now, in order to eliminate the possibility of any such tracking, different types of encryption algorithm may be used during the transmission of those zeros and ones. Similarly, the corresponding decryption algorithm has to be provided at the receiving end so that the entire communication from the transmitting side to the receiving side is made much more secure. So that is only possible whenever you are using zeros and ones, a train of zeros and ones for the transmission of the message signal or information bearing signal. So after unique representation, the enhanced security is the second advantage associated with a PCM system. The third advantage lies in the fact that this particular modulation system, this pulse code modulation, is much more immune to noise and interference. So immunity to noise and interference. So this is another important advantage which you can point out over here. So as you know, in case of a PCM system, we are not sending the actual value of the message signal. Rather, the corresponding sample value is being encoded by virtue of zeros and ones, and these zeros and ones are sent through the channel. So instead of transmitting the actual information, we are sending some pulse, and this pulse waveform is immune to noise and interference. And this has been guaranteed by regenerating those pulses during the course of transmission within the channel. So it gives rise to the next advantage associated with the PCM, that means regeneration of pulse. Regeneration of waveforms. So as you have seen, between the transmitter and receiver, there are several regenerative repeaters are placed, whose sole purpose is to eliminate the effect of any distortion which is present within the transmitted signal and to generate a fresh pulse in accordance with the algorithm already incorporated within that particular block. So this regeneration of waveform is only possible whenever you are taking the help of a pulse coded modulation system. So in a nutshell, these are the different advantages which you can point out in connection to a PCM system. On the other hand, as you know, whenever we talk about an advantage, so it is always accompanied with some limitations. For any system, advantage and disadvantage are coming together. So let us try to identify what are the limitations associated with a PCM system. First of all, as you understand from the transmitter and the receiver block diagram, which we have discussed in the last class, that there are several other blocks which you might not have in case of traditional analog modulation system. You have blocks like sampler, you have blocks like quantizer, encoder, reconstruction filter, and anti-aliasing filter. So there are different blocks. So as a matter of fact, this PCM system is much more complex as far as the infrastructure is concerned, as far as the hardware complexity is concerned. So complexity is one of the issue which we must deal with proper care in connection to a PCM system. Complexity of the design or complexity of the transmitter and receiver. So I can also write this like complexity of the design. So we do have to perform some pre-processing operation. We have the analog signal at our hand. We have to transmit this information in the form of digital means. So as a matter of fact, this analog to digital conversion has to be done. And then the digital signal is propagated through the channel by virtue of different means. And once again at the receiving end, we do the reverse operation, this digital to analog conversion. So we are doing the same thing in order to exploit some of the advantages of transmitting the digital information. So complexity of the design is one of the limitations associated with the PCM system. And second one is the requirement of higher bandwidth. Requirement of higher bandwidth. So I'm coming to that. What do you mean by that? This requirement of higher bandwidth. Now, out of these two limitations, this complexity of design can be taken care of by virtue of the revolution made in the area of VLSI design. So as you know, nowadays, there has been a significant improvement as far as the hardware complexity of any structure is concerned. So that's why, to some extent, we can get rid of this complexity of the design. And so therefore, this pulse code modulation system is having the only one limitation in the form of requirement of higher bandwidth, because this complexity of the design will be taken care of by the revolution made in the area of VLSI design. Now, what do you mean by the requirement of higher bandwidth? So let me tell you very briefly. If I have any signal like this, let me have a signal as a function of time. Let the signal is represented by xt. So let the signal is represented in the time domain by means of this waveform. Now we are interested in observing the signal in the frequency domain. and let the signal is band limited, let the signal is band limited to W. Let the signal is band limited to W. What do you mean by that? That means the maximum frequency present within the signal is W. So W could have been a few kilohertz or few hertz or even few megahertz for video signal or picture signal. For audio signal, it is like few tens of kilohertz. But if you consider video signal or image signal, so in that case, the highest frequency present within the signal might be even larger. Anyway, suppose the highest frequency present within the signal is represented by W. Now, if you consider transmitting the signal by virtue of some analog modulation scheme, so let me tell you very briefly. Let us consider, say, amplitude modulation with double sideband scheme. So in case of AM-DSB, if the actual signal is having a bandwidth of W, then AM-DSB requires a bandwidth of 2W for this transmission. For AM-SSB, single sideband modulation, the requirement of bandwidth is W only. So in other words, I can say that whenever we consider amplitude modulation, I mean the analog modulation, in case of analog modulation, the corresponding bandwidth requirement is relatively small. So it is in the range of W. Now, what happens for digital transmission? You know, in order to allow those information being represented by means of some coded pulse, first of all, the operation which you need to perform is the sampling operation. And the sampling is done in a way so that the reconstruction is possible at the receiving end. So this is done in accordance with the sampling theorem. So sampling theorem tells that the sampling rate Fs must be greater than or equal to twice W. This is greater than or equal to twice W. Now what happens based on that? Some samples are taken. Some samples are taken. And the duration, if I just consider some samples are taken, and this time duration between two consecutive samples is nothing but Ts. So this duration is Ts, which is known as the sampling duration, which is equal to 1 by Fs. So Ts must be less than or equal to 1 by 2W. Now last day we have discussed about encoding operation. Now each of these sample after quantization, so obviously there will be some quantization. So instead of having a continuously varying sample in the analog, in the amplitude domain, you have discrete variation in the samples. And as a matter of fact, these levels are discretized, these amplitude levels are discretized. And then each of the quantized sample is represented by means of some numbers. So if I want to represent any particular sample by R number of such bits, so in that case, suppose this sample is represented by R number of bits, the next sample will also be represented by R number of bits. So as a matter of fact, these R bits are to be represented within a time span of Ts. If I go to the next slide, suppose I'm having a signal like this, as I was mentioning. This is time, and you have a signal like this. This is the variation, and I'm just taking the samples like this, considering the Nyquist sampling theorem. Now suppose the difference between two consecutive samples is given by Ts, which is equal to 1 upon Fs. Now each of the sample is being represented by R number of bits. Suppose R equal to 8. So each of the sample, each quantized sample I must write, because after sampling, the next operation involved is quantization. So each quantized sample is being represented by R bits, R number of bits. So R could have been 8 or 16 or 32, 64, depending upon the power efficiency and bandwidth efficiency as prescribed by the system designer. So therefore, within this time duration of Ts, R bit has to be represented, and this R bit is represented by means of sending pulses. So last day we have discussed about the different types of line coding technique. So if I consider the simplest one, the NRZ unipolar kind of thing, and suppose the corresponding value of R equal to 8, and a particular sample is being represented by, say, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1010. Suppose this is the corresponding sample which is being represented by means of this 8 bits 1000 1010. So obviously it has to be represented in this particular fashion. I'm considering NRZ unipolar kind of representation, line coding format. Now this corresponds to, say, first sample. So this is the first sample, first quantized sample. It has been encoded into 8 bits, and after encoding, the corresponding bit pattern is obtained like 1000 1010. Now this entire thing has to be represented within the time span of TS. So as a matter of fact, what will be the bit duration? The bit duration TB is nothing but TS by R. So in this case, TS by 8. Bit duration is TS by 8, where R is equal to 8. And you know, whenever this particular pulse is being represented in the frequency domain, the corresponding frequency requirement, as you know, in the frequency domain, it looks something like that, a sync function. And if I just consider this particular band as the first zero crossing, then obviously this bandwidth is inversely proportional to TB. This is inversely proportional to TB. That means if this bit duration is more, then the bandwidth requirement will be less, and vice versa. Now what is TB? TB is equal to TS upon R. So the bandwidth, or resultant bandwidth, is proportional to R by TS. Now TS is fixed. Sampling duration is fixed by virtue of FS, or sampling rate. So the bandwidth is directly proportional to the number of bits used to represent any particular sample. So the bandwidth requirement for transmitting the signal is directly proportional to the number of bits used to represent that particular sample. So you may argue that the bandwidth requirement can be minimized by reducing the value of R. That is not at all acceptable. Why? Because, you know, the number of bits is also represented by means of this formula, L is equal to 2 to the power R. What is L? L is the number of levels. L is the number of levels in connection to quantization. If I have 8 number of bits, then I could have at most 2 to the power 8 or 256 levels. And perhaps you can remember that L is also dependent upon the value of delta. That means the step size. So what was that? So this is nothing but the dynamic range of the input signal divided by L. So if you make any attempt to reduce the value of R in order to reduce the corresponding bandwidth, because bandwidth is directly proportional to the number of bits. So if you want to reduce the bandwidth, you need to reduce R, the number of bits per sample, or bit rate rather. And if you make any attempt to reduce R, this will eventually reduce the number of levels. If you make R is equal to 8, then the levels will be 256. If you make R is equal to 10, then the levels will be 1024. If you make R is equal to 4, then the levels will be 16. So if you increase R, there will be more levels. If you reduce R, there will be less number of levels. But to save bandwidth, you need to reduce the number of bits. So if you reduce R, L will be reduced. And for a fixed dynamic range of the input signal, if you reduce L, then the delta value will be enhanced. So as a matter of fact, if you reduced R, then the bandwidth will be reduced. That is fine. Now, this implies L will be reduced, and this implies delta will be increased. Now, if you increase delta, what happens? You know, the corresponding quantization noise power is given by del square by 12. We have already calculated this part in some previous lecture. So if you reduce delta, then obviously your quantization noise power will be less. But if you make any attempt to reduce R, the number of bits per sample, then consequently it will increase the value of delta, that means the step size. Because suppose the dynamic range of the input signal is fixed. Now, if you make any attempt to reduce the number of levels by reducing R, automatically the delta value will be more. And as a matter of fact, the quantization noise power will also be more. So, which will not help us in any way. So, we need to devise some mechanism so that we can take the help of this PCM system, but at the same time, we can transmit the information in an efficient manner by consuming less bandwidth. So, for the last few minutes, I was talking about the requirement of higher bandwidth. That means this particular limitation pertaining to PCM system. So, we need to devise some mechanism so that this particular limitation of a pulse code modulation technique can be eliminated. And this has been done with the aid of a modification of a traditional pulse code modulation technique. And this technique is known as differential pulse code modulation. So let me start with the name. In case of differential pulse code modulation scheme, which is also known as DPCM in short, differential pulse code modulation or DPCM in short. The limitation of PCM is addressed to some extent. Now, what is done in case of DPCM system? In case of DPCM system, you have the analog signal, information bearing analog signal, T versus XT. This is the signal, for example. And if it is band limited by W, then the sampling rate must be greater than or equal to twice W, as you know from the Nyquist sampling theorem. Now, in case of differential pulse code modulation, what is done? The sampling rate of the signal is chosen to be sufficiently higher as compared to the Nyquist sampling rate. For example, if W is equal to, say, let it be 10 kilohertz, then you know, then the Nyquist sampling theorem says that the sampling rate should be 20 kilohertz, 20 or higher than 20 kilohertz. Now, in case of DPCM system, the sampling rate is made higher than 20 kilohertz. Let it be like 100 kilohertz or 200 kilohertz. That means the actual sampling rate is made higher as compared to the actual sampling rate is made higher as compared to the Nyquist sampling rate. So here for DPCM, we are taking more number of samples. That means the sampling rate has been enhanced to a significant level. Now, what advantage we are getting out of that? If I take samples one after another with a very high sampling rate, what advantage we are extracting out of that? The advantage is that if you take more number of samples over a certain range of time, then there is a possibility that the correlation between two consecutive samples is much more. That means if I take, let me consider two different scenario. Suppose this is one scenario. Let me draw the same signal once again. Let me draw the same signal, same excursion. Let it be something like that. I will try to replicate the above waveform as much as possible. Now let us consider two scenario. In one case, I am taking the sample at Nyquist rate. Suppose this is the Nyquist rate. I'm taking the sample in accordance with the Nyquist sampling rate. That is, let it be say 20 kilohertz. So if I take the sample at a rate of 20 kilohertz, then obviously I'll be able to reconstruct the signal. There is no problem. And the second case, so here I am taking FS equal to 20 kilohertz. Now, since the signal frequency is 10 kilohertz, I mean the highest bandwidth is 10 kilohertz. So if I take the sample at a rate of 20 kilohertz, that means 20 kilo samples per second, then obviously I can once again reconstruct the signal at the receiving end. But the Nyquist theorem says that FS can be equal to twice W or greater than twice W. Now, in case of DPCM, what is done? The sampling rate is made higher with respect to the Nyquist sampling rate. So let it be say 200 kilohertz or 100 kilohertz, just like this. So I'm taking more number of samples. Say 5 times more samples. So instead of having FS equal 20 kilohertz this time, let I have say 100 kilohertz as the sampling rate. So you understand from the drawing. So here I am taking more number of samples, FS equal to 100 kilohertz. So 5 times more as compared to the previous sampling rate. Now what happens by virtue of this kind of sampling? If I just compare to consecutive sample, you'll see that there is a lot of similarity. That means the correlation between two consecutive samples is much higher as compared to the previous case. Now here, if I consider these two samples, so this value, this is the first sample, this is the second sample, then this is the third sample, fourth sample. So there has been a change, and this change cannot be tracked by those samples. However, here, since I am taking some more number of samples over here, I am taking dense sample. So as a matter of fact, the correlation or similarity between the consecutive sample is much larger. So then the people have thought that instead of transmitting the actual sample value, if I represent the difference between the consecutive sample value, then obviously it will help us in reducing the value of delta even for a fixed L. Let me tell the statement once again. Since in case of DPCM, more number of samples, dense samples are taken, obeying the Nyquist sampling theorem, instead of taking FS equal to 2W, in case of DPCM, the sampling rate is taken to be much, much larger as compared to the minimum sampling rate as prescribed by Nyquist. So by virtue of this operation, the correlation or similarity between two consecutive samples is made higher. So instead of transmitting the actual sample value, if somebody sends the difference between two consecutive sample value, then the difference is having a lower dynamic range as compared to the actual input signal or actual sample signal. In other words, the dynamic range of the input signal can be reduced to some extent significantly if instead of sending the samples, we send the difference value. For example, let me tell you in terms of some example. Say the actual sample, I mean, if I consider this one, in this case, suppose minimum sample value is represented by, let it be say 1 unit. And the maximum sample value, let it be say 5 unit. So dynamic range 5 minus 1, that is 4. Now here, I am not sending the actual sample value. Suppose this value is equal to 1.5 and the next sample is equal to 1.6. So I'm not sending this 1.5 or 1.6. Rather, I'm just sending the difference. So here, if I want to represent the difference, so then you find that say difference mean is equal to say, let it be say minus 0.5. And difference max equal to say plus 1.5. So I'm just taking some arbitrary value, dip max equal to 1.5 or even small. So if I consider this one, you'll see the dynamic range is like 5 to 1, that is 4. And here the dynamic range is 1.5 to minus 0.5, so that means 2. In fact, the value of the dynamic, I mean, the value of the difference signal will be even less. It is not like 0.5 or 1.5, it will be even less, like 0.05 or 0.15. So it depends upon the predictor circuit which you must incorporate into your transmitter. So anyway, so by some means, if I take more number of samples, then the corresponding correlation or similarity between two consecutive samples is even large. So I must not write like 0.5, otherwise it might create some confusion. So let it be even small. If the prediction is proper, then it will be like, suppose it will be like minus 0.05, and suppose this one is like plus 0.15. So let me make it 1 degree smaller. So in that case, what will be the dynamic range? The dynamic range will be 0.2 only. However, the dynamic range here is 4. So significant improvement in terms of the dynamic range. Even if the input signal is the same, but we are not sending the actual information. Rather, we are just sending the difference information. So the difference signal is having a lower variance as compared to the actual information. So actual information is having a variance more as compared to the difference signal. Now, if by some means we can transmit the difference information, then now the delta value, as you understand, is nothing but the dynamic range. So in the numerator, you have the dynamic range, and in the denominator, so let me write like, say, diff r. So this is the dynamic range of the difference signal divided upon L. And this time, your delta was like mr divided by L. Now, even if I select a fixed value of r in both these two cases, r means the number of bits, and you know r and L, they are represented by this particular formula, L is equal to 2 to the power r. So even if r is fixed, the number of bits is fixed, if I can reduce the dynamic range of the input signal to some extent, then obviously, even for a fixed value of L, the corresponding value of delta, let it be delta 1, suppose this is delta 2. So since diff r is less than mr, so even for a fixed r value, even for a fixed number of bits, the corresponding step size will be reduced, and people are taking the advantage of this reduced step size in case of differential pulse code modulation. So let me try to draw the circuitry first of any DPCM system. So as you know, in case of DPCM system, we are not sending the actual information. Rather, we are sending the difference information. So we do have an actual information or actual message signal, sampled signal. We do have the actual message signal, but we are not sending this one. This is the sampled input. That means the actual input, MN or MNTS, sampled input. So which is represented by M of N. So for the sake of simplicity, I'm representing by virtue of M of N. Because as you know, if I just go back over here, MN or XN doesn't matter. As you know, the samples are represented by X of NTS because it is taken at every TS. So since TS is fixed everywhere, so I can always represent these samples by means of X of N only. It doesn't mean that TS equal to 1, but since TS is everywhere within the argument, so I can simply omit this particular variable. So this is the sampled input as we are getting over here. And we are not sending the sampled input directly to the quantizer block. In case of a traditional PCM system, as you have seen, the sampled input was directly fed to the quantizer. And then after the quantizer, there was an encoder block. Now here, the sampled input is not directly sent to the quantizer block. Rather, it is sent through a comparator block. So which compares this input, MN, with an estimate of MN. So this is the estimation of MN, so which I would like to represent by, say, M cap N. So this estimation is being performed, is being carried out by a circuit which is known as a predictor circuit. So at the output of this comparator, we do have the difference signal. That means the error in estimation. So this is nothing but EN, which is nothing but the difference between MN and M cap N. So MN was the actual sampled input, and M cap N is the estimated version of MN. And if the estimation is perfect, then the EN will be small. And if the estimation is not good enough, then the EN value could have been large. But on an average, I can say that the variance of the actual signal MN is much, much larger as compared to the variance of the error signal EN. Now this error signal is being fed to the quantizer. Error signal is being fed to the quantizer. So this error signal will act as input signal for the quantizer, and the quantizer output, so let it be EQM. This quantizer output is developed over here, and the quantizer output is being fed to the encoder, just like a PCM system. And you have the wave over here. Then the next question is that how do you get the value of M cap N? Obviously, this is obtained from a predictor circuit. So what will be the input of the predictor circuit? So here, this predictor circuit predicts the sample based upon the previous predicted value and the error signal generated. So this is the previously predicted value M cap N. Now this, along with the error signal, this error signal will give you some information regarding the accuracy of prediction. So these two together, or what I can do is I can simply add them. Simply add a circuit. These two together is being fed at the input of the predictor. And the output is obtained over here, which is being fed to the input of the comparator. So this is the predictor circuit. Now, as you understand, the error signal EN is nothing but the difference between the actual signal MN, actual sampled input MN, and its estimation, that is M cap N. So M cap N is obtained from the predictor circuit itself. So their difference is error signal. And this error signal is being quantized by virtue of the quantizer block. So I can always write this quantized output is equal to the input to the quantizer, plus you do have a quantization noise, EN plus QN. And as you understand, this quantization noise can be either positive or negative depending upon the amplitude of the error signal. So EQN is given by EN plus QN. Then what about the signal over here? So if I want to represent, this is by say some MQN, which is the input to the predictor. So I can write this MQN as a summation of M cap N plus EQN. So this predictor circuit needs the information regarding the previously predicted sample and the status of the error signal, rather quantized error signal. So this is nothing but M cap N, and I can write EQN as EN plus QN. EN plus QN. Now what about M cap N plus EN? So M cap plus EN is given by MN. So this is equal to, this MQN is equal to MN plus QN. So while predicting the sample value at any particular instant, the predictor needs to know what about the sample value at the previous instant, actual sample value, and what about the quantization noise, or what about the quantization error. Now taking into consideration the value of MN and QN, the value of M cap N will be generated. So today I'm not going to discuss how to generate or how to develop M cap N from MQN. So that will be discussed perhaps in the next class. But let us assume that given the value of MQN at the input of any predictor, then the predictor circuit will be able to develop M cap N depending upon the value of MQN. And eventually this EQN, which is the quantized error signal, is being fed to the encoder, and at the output of the encoder, you will be getting what is known as a DPCM wave. So what advantage we are getting out of that? Since the error signal is having a variance which is much small as compared to the variance of the actual signal MN, so therefore the step size involved within this quantization operation is small with respect to what we could get for MN only. Now, since the delta value has been reduced, so the corresponding quantization noise will also be reduced, and it will help in consuming the bandwidth in an efficient way for a fixed number of levels. Now, this is the transmitter circuit. So let me write down the name over here. So as you understand, this is the transmitter block. This is the transmitter block of a transmitter of a DPCM system. Similarly, you need to understand how does the receiver block of any DPCM system look like. Now, obviously, at the input, we do have a decoder, because at the very last block of the encoder, at the very last block of a transmitter, you have an encoder block. So here you do have a decoder block, which will decode the channel output to a train of pulses. Then the decoder block will be there, and after the decoder block, we need to provide. So you understand that at the output of the decoder, we should expect EQN. If I just once again go back to the previous slide, here EQN was provided at the input of the encoder and the DPCM was generated. If I assume that there was no externally available noise or interference signal over here, so we can expect that the DPCM wave, which has been generated from this particular end, will be available over here as channel output, assuming that the channel is ideal and it imposes no noise or no distortion or no interference. So under this ideal condition, we can expect that this decoder output is nothing but the encoder input. So the decoder output will be EQN only. Now, what you need to develop? You need to develop MN. What do you have? You have EQN. Now, how to get MN from EQN? How do you get that? You need to take the help of a predictor circuit. So what do you have is, you'll be having a predictor circuit. The same predictor circuit will be there as was used in the transmitter. Now there will be summer. Adder block will be there. This output over here . So predictor output is M cap N. So if I want to have what is there, this particular signal. So this particular signal is nothing but M cap N plus EQN. Now what was that value? The estimated signal, estimated message signal at any time instant N plus the quantized noise. So I can write this like, so EQN can be represented like EN plus QN, the error signal plus the quantization noise associated with the error signal. Now, as you know, M cap N plus EN is nothing but the actual signal MN. So MN plus QN. So what do you have over here? You basically have MN plus QN. So except the quantization noise, which you cannot get rid of in any sense, except the quantization noise, you are at this particular end, you are able to retrieve the actual signal element. So you are sending the quantized error signal through the channel so that the variance of the transmitted signal can be reduced significantly. But at the receiving end, you are able to regenerate the actual message signal MN. So here we will be getting this signal is nothing but the actual message signal MN plus the quantization noise. So obviously, since you have incorporated the quantization operation in the transmitter block, so you cannot get rid of the quantization noise. So quantization noise will be there, but by encoding the error signal by virtue of this DPCM system, it is possible to reduce the dynamic range of the transmitted signal, and by using a same number of labels or accepted number of bits per sample, you are able to reduce the step size of the transmission. So as a matter of fact, this DPCM system for a fixed number of levels, for a fixed number of bits per sample, this DPCM system will be able to produce lower quantization noise. So as you understand, this is the receiver block. This is the receiver block of a DPCM system. So sometimes you do have a low pass filter over here, and the external noises or interference which might creep into the signal during the transmission, that can be eliminated by those low pass filter over here, and ultimately you'll be getting the signal empty at the output of this receiver. Now this is all about the basic understanding regarding the differential pulse code modulation, whose fundamental objective is to reduce the quantization noise by encoding the error signal instead of encoding the actual signal during the transmission. Now the I would like to emphasize on the second topic of today's discussion. This is known as the DM, delta modulation, which is known to be a particular type of DPCM in which case this quantization is a 1-bit quantization. So this DPCM, as I was mentioning, differential pulse code modulation, the second one which I am going to describe right now, which is also known as delta modulation. So delta modulation is not a new concept at all. So delta modulation is nothing but a special case of DPCM. So if you understood properly DPCM system, then you'll be able to understand the delta modulation as well. So this is a special case of DPCM, delta modulation, or DM in short. The speciality comes in the form of quantization. So this is a kind of thing, this is a kind of PCM system where 1-bit quantization is used. 1-bit quantization. What do you mean by 1-bit quantization? That means the error signal is encoded into two levels. So here the number of bit is only 1. So you can have only two possibilities, either the positive error or negative error, and accordingly the signal will be developed. Now before going into the transmitter and receiver block of a DM system, let me show you how does a DM system, a delta modulation system, works. Suppose this is the input signal. This is the MT message signal which you are considering right now. This is the variation of the message signal, MT. Now in case of delta modulation, obviously first of all we need to find out the sampled value. So instead of representing MT, I should have a MN kind of thing. That means the sampled value of the message signal, and then this sampled value of the message signal is compared with the corresponding estimated value of the message signal. But for the sake of understanding, I would like to represent the signal as a continuous waveform. Then you can understand the flavor of this DM system. So this is the message signal which you are considering empty. And there will be some estimated version of the message signal. Now, to start with, suppose this is the estimated value. Let this be the time instant to start with. Suppose this is the estimated value. Now here, this is the estimated value. And now if you compare the estimated value with the actual value, you find that the estimated value is less as compared to the actual value. Then what happens? The error signal will be positive because this is nothing but mn minus m cap n, or in other words, mt minus m cap t. So here mt is more, but m cap t is less. Now, if this is the level, so obviously the error signal will be positive. So what is done? The corresponding level will be positive since there are two levels associated with DM. So to start with, let me first draw, then you can understand. So using this green, I am representing the estimated value. Estimated value of the message signal, which is nothing but a staircase approximation of the input signal. I think it will be slightly more, this one. Remember that the step sizes are uniform over here. It looks something like that. So this one, which I have drawn using this green, so this is the estimated value. This is MQT. And this difference is delta. This difference is delta. Now, what about the signal being transmitted? Actually, you need to transmit zeros and ones through the transmission channel. Now, to transmit the signal, you have to compare. What about the difference between the MT and MQT? So here, as you observe over here, the difference here is negative. I mean, MT is more as compared to MQT. Now, if you compare this MT and MQT, the difference will be positive over here. So that's why within this, you need to transmit one. Then another positive pulse. So then one. Then I think it will be better if I draw over here. Otherwise, it can create some confusion. Let me draw beneath the pulse. So here you transmit one. Here you transmit one. You transmit zero here. One, 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 zero, one, zero. 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. So this is the bit pattern which you transmit. 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. 00100101. So this is the bit pattern which you transmit over the channel. So the bit pattern is represented by this red. The blue one is the actual signal MT, which you sample at some sampling instant. So you need to sample at those instant. So let me just show you the instant at which you compare. You compare over here. Once again, you compare at this particular point. You compare here. So the samples are taken at uniform interval and the corresponding values are compared. Now this is all about the basic understanding regarding a delta modulation system. Then now we are in a position to draw the corresponding transmitter circuit of any DM system. Now, just like the previous transmitter block, once again, we do have a same architecture. So we have a comparator over here, which will compare the sampled signal MN with its estimated version. And the output of this comparator is being fed to a quantizer, but this time the quantizer is a 1-bit quantizer, a 2-level quantizer, 1-bit quantizer. And another change will be there in the predictor circuit. So then ultimately you do have an encoder over here. This is the encoder block. And ultimately you have DMO wave. In the predictor circuit, you have a single bit delay. 1-bit delay as the predictor circuit. So this is a special case of DPCM. So you have a 1-bit delay. So sometimes in DSP, it is also represented by Z inverse. If you know the concept of Z transformation, then in Z domain, the 1-bit delay in the natural domain is represented by Z inverse in the Z domain. So this is the output of the predictor circuit, which is being fed to the input of the comparator. So the comparator will compare these two input, MN and this one. And then we have an adder circuit over here, which will compute these two together, which will add. So this is the EN value. You would have EQN over here, the quantized error signal. And this one is MQN, as we mentioned previously, this is MQN. And here, since there is a 1-bit delay in the predictor circuit, so obviously this output, which we have represented last time by MCAPN, so this time, since MQN is the input to the 1-bit delay, so this output can equivalently be represented by MQN minus 1. So this is equivalent to MCAP of N. So MQN minus 1, because MQN is the input to this 1-bit delay. So the output of the 1-bit delay is nothing but MQN minus 1. So this is the actual message signal MN. This is the predicted value. At the previous instant, you need to compare these two together. If the error signal is positive, that means if MN is higher than MQN minus 1, then a pulse of amplitude plus delta will be developed. Plus delta will be developed, as you obtain over here. If the error signal is positive, that means if MN is higher than MQN minus 1, so in that case, a pulse of amplitude delta plus delta will be developed. And in case the error signal goes negative, EN is negative, so in that case, a pulse of amplitude minus delta will be developed, just like this, whenever the 0 is developed over here. So one can write this one as this EQN. This error signal can be represented as EN plus QN, as obvious, and MQN was given by MQN minus 1 plus EQN. Now, depending upon the value of EN, if the EN is positive, that means if MN is greater than, if MN is greater than MQN minus 1, that means if the actual signal value is greater than its estimated value, MQN minus 1, then you understand that EN will be positive. it implies that En is positive, En is greater than zero, and then a positive pulse will be developed over here. Then I can write Eqn as plus delta. On the other hand, then Eqn is equal to plus delta. On the other hand, if Mn is less than Mqn minus 1, that means if the estimated value is more, which implies En is negative, in that case, Eqn, the error signal, the quantized error signal, is represented by sending a pulse of amplitude minus delta. So therefore, one can write is Eqn, the quantized error signal, as delta multiplied with signum of EI. So signum function, perhaps you know what is meant by signum function. There is no need to provide this bracket. I think this is irrelevant. Signum of EI. So how does it look like, signum function? So let me show you x versus signum x. Perhaps you know this one. There are two levels, plus 1 and minus 1. For x greater than 0, signum x equal to plus 1. For x less than 0, signum x equal to minus 1. And for x equal to 0, you can take an arbitrary value for signum function. So here also, Eqn for any particular n. Oh, I should write n here. It's not I, rather it should be n. This is n. Delta signum of En. So if En is greater than 0, then plus delta will be developed because signum function will give you plus 1. And if En is negative, in that case, this signum function will develop minus 1, and then Eqn will be minus delta. Then if we write this Mqn, I mean this one, the input to the 1-bit delay. So the input to the 1-bit delay, Mqn, as you find, this is nothing but Mqn minus 1 plus Eqn. So this is nothing but delta. It is an accumulator. I is equal to 1 to n signum function of EI. And accordingly, this Mqn will be developed. So depending on the error signal, either you have plus 1 contribution or you have minus 1 contribution. So if I just write if I just write down over here the expression for Mqn over here, so this Mqn, as we got, is given by delta summation Sgn of EI. And I is going from 1 to n. Now, if you want to compare this one with this particular waveform, so this green waveform is for MQT or MQN. So this is nothing but a staircase approximation of the actual signal MT or MN, staircase approximation, where the step size is given by delta. Now, for any particular time instant, from say n minus 1 TS to NTS, within a particular time duration, either a pulse of amplitude plus delta or a pulse of amplitude minus delta will be developed depending upon the sign of the error signal generated. Now here, if the error signal is positive because Mn is greater than Mqn minus 1, so signum EI will be plus 1, so plus delta will be developed over here. Then once again, this is added, plus delta, then minus delta, then plus delta, plus delta. So in this way, the actual message signal is being traced by this staircase approximation MQT. So this is the transmitter block of the delta modulation system, a DM system. Similarly, if I want to draw the receiver block, you can do it very easily, just like a receiver block of a DPCM system. So here, you do have a decoder at the very beginning to receive the channel output, the DM, the channel output, delta modulated output over here, and the quantized noise will be developed over here, EQN, and then it is added with MQN minus one, and this is nothing but a simple adder circuit, adder block. So this one is the transmitter. Transmitter of DM, transmitter block. And if I want to draw the receiver block over here, transmitter block, and this is the DM output. I forget to mention, this is the delta modulator output, DM output. So if I want to draw the receiver block, so at the very beginning, you do have a decoder, which will decode the channel output into a quantized noise. Then you have this adder block. And 1-bit delay as the same predictor circuit as was used in the transmitter end. And this will be added together. So actually, these two blocks together, ultimately, you do have a low pass filter to retrieve MT from those samples. So there will be an LPF over here. And ultimately, you do have MN. Actually, these two blocks together is nothing but an accumulator, adder and delay. So these two blocks together, this 1-bit delay along with this adder together, this is known as accumulator. Because once again, if you look at the expression for MQN, you'll see that MQN is nothing but the summation of those EI, the error signal. So this is known as accumulator, which will accumulate the error and it will produce the estimated value of the signal MT. This is a receiver block, as you understand, receiver of delta modulation system. And here we do expect that the actual signal MT is being represented with some quantization noise, which you cannot get rid of at the output of this low pass filter. Now, this delta modulation is having some serious implication for the transmission of these information bearing signals through a channel. However, the selection of delta is very important for the proper operation of the circuit itself. As you understand, the value of delta has something to say regarding the correctness of the detector block, or regarding the correctness of this predictor block. For example, let me consider a situation like this. Let me consider a situation like this, where the input signal goes something like that. Suppose there has been a steep rise of the input signal from this range, from this point to that point. Now suppose I would like, so this is the actual signal MT. This is the actual signal MT, which I want to represent by means of its approximation. This is the MT signal, message signal. And I would like to represent it by virtue of its approximation. So the approximation starts from this point. So what happens? Initially, you find that the approximated value or the estimated value is much small as compared to the actual value. So the positive error signal will be developed and a staircase approximation will be generated like this. And then you will find a situation where the corresponding approximated signal will haunt between two levels, plus delta and minus delta. So accordingly, this delta modulation system is experiencing two different noises. So as you understand, this particular portion, if you just consider this particular staircase approximation of the input signal, you do agree that it cannot track the actual input signal, because the actual input signal looks something like that, which has been represented by MT, and this one is MQT, which you want to transmit or which you want to develop at the output of the DM system. Now, this one, this MT and MQT, over here, you find there has been a lot of change. In other words, I can say that MQT cannot track MT over this period of the input signal, where the input signal increases sharply. On the other hand, when the input signal is remaining almost constant, during this part, you will find that the corresponding MQT, that means the estimated version or the approximated version of the message signal, is struggling between two different levels. So as a matter of fact, this DM system is also experiencing two different types of noise. This noise is known as slope overload distortion or slope overload noise, in which case this is known as slope overload noise or slope overload distortion, in which case the steepness of the input signal is much, much larger as compared to the height of this staircase approximation. So here I am considering it is like a linear delta modulator, in which case the delta value, that means the step size, is remaining constant. So step size is uniform, so delta is constant. But however, the local slope characteristics over here implies a sharp increase, a sharp rise of the input signal. And for this value of delta, for a particular value of delta, it cannot track the input signal properly. And as a matter of fact, a kind of distortion takes place in the transmitter circuit, and which we refer like a slope overload distortion. So this slope overload distortion happens only when the slope of the input signal is much, much larger as compared to the height of this staircase approximation. On the other hand, over here, when the input signal changes very slowly within this particular range, where the fluctuation is very small. So here, if you find the slope is very large and here the slope is very small, it changes very slowly. So in which case you find that the staircase approximation will haunt around a DC level. And it also gives rise to a kind of noise, which is referred by granular noise. So eventually there are two types of noise with the different implications. So you must understand over here, in order to ensure that the slope overload distortion is arrested by virtue of delta modulation system, we have to ensure that the slope of this one, slope of this particular graph, this staircase approximation, which is nothing but delta by Ts, slope of this graph is delta by Ts, because delta is the height and this particular width is Ts. So if I just compute the corresponding slope, so the slope is nothing but perpendicular by Ps, that is delta by Ts. So this delta by Ts must be greater than or equal to the maximum of dmt dt. Max of dmt dt. So if this condition is satisfied, then one can get rid of the slope overload distortion. That means the slope of this particular waveform, slope of the approximated signal, must be greater or equal to the maximum slope of the input signal. So in that case, we can arrest the slope overload distortion. So for this particular case, as you understand, if the slope is very large, slope of the input signal is very large, DMD dt max is very large, then for a fixed value of TS, I need to increase the delta. That means to address this slope overload distortion, the delta value has to be high over here. On the other hand, if I just consider the granular noise, once again, you understand that there is a kind of noise, there is a kind of quantization noise which has been incorporated by virtue of this transmission, and that can only be reduced if I reduce the value of delta. So this granular noise can be arrested if the delta value is reduced. So as you find, there are two different requirements and contradictory requirements. In one case, to eliminate the slope overload distortion, you require the delta value should be high enough so that it can track the input signal very quickly. And in other case, you find that in order to eliminate the granular noise, or in order to eliminate any possibility of granular noise, you need to reduce the value of the step size. But any particular arbitrary waveform, you do have the appearance of both slope overload distortion and granular noise. In other words, I can say that in any particular waveform, suppose this message signal would have been something like that. Message signal, let the message signal look something like that. There could have been pretty sharp rise over here, and at the same time, the local slope characteristics could have been as small as zero. But you are using a fixed value of delta as far as the notion of linear delta modulator is concerned. So linear delta modulator means what? So whenever I say linear delta modulator, linear DM, that means fixed delta. Fixed delta. That means the corresponding value of the approximated signal, it increases or decreases along a straight line. If I just consider this one, it increases or decreases along a straight line. Along a straight line, and the slope of the straight line remaining constant, either plus delta by TS or minus delta by TS. Now here, in any particular signal, if it looks something like that, a sharp rise over here, and then almost no variation over here, then to address the slope overload distortion and granular noise together, you have to change the value of delta in an adaptive way. So you cannot use a linear delta modulator for your operation, because if you select a value of delta which is small enough, so in that case you can get rid of granular noise, or the granular noise can be eliminated to some extent, but the lower value of delta will enhance the possibility of slope overload distortion. On the other hand, if a very high value of delta is selected, then the slope overload distortion may be arrested, it can be avoided to some extent, but the higher value of delta will give rise to higher granular noise. So therefore, in order to arrest, or in order to address these two types of noises together, or to eliminate the appearance of these two types of noises, what is needed, instead of having a fixed value of delta in your construction, you do require a kind of delta modulation for which the delta value is not at all constant, rather it changes depending upon the local slope characteristics of the input signal. And this type of the solution is that adaptive delta modulator. Adaptive delta modulator. Adaptive DM, that means a variable step size. Variable delta. So the delta value is no longer constant, rather it depends upon the local slope characteristics of the input signal, unlike this linear delta modulator. Now with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on DPCM and DM.